So a lot of you guys seem to want to know how I did this, and this, and this, and this, and this, and this. So I thought I'd make a video and show you, and I've made a little After Effects tutorial, but I realised that not all of you know After Effects and some of you don't want to bother, so I've also made an asset pack for Premiere Pro, where I have some Mogarts, which are motion graphic templates that you can simply drag and drop. I've made some fonts, and I've also made a LUT that you can put on your footage and it will make it look all old and retro. So let me show you a little preview of the asset pack, and then I'll show you how to use it and how to install it, and then we'll go into a more in-depth After Effects tutorial if you just want to do this yourself. And if you want to skip to any part of the video, these are the time codes on the screen now. Let's go. So let me show you how easy this is to work in Premiere Pro. You don't even need After Effects installed for this one. You just need to have the latest version of Premiere Pro through a Creative Cloud subscription. So first off, you're going to want to make sure that your Creative Cloud is logged in and that your Premiere Pro is up to date. Now, that makes sure the motion graphics templates are going to work, and being logged in makes sure the Adobe fonts are going to load up properly because the motion graphics templates use them. So let's open Premiere Pro. So once you're in Premiere Pro, you need to find your Essential Graphics tab. Now, if that's not showing, you can go to Window and you can go to Essential Graphics to make sure it's there. So in here, we have all the various motion graphics templates here. All the ones that start with JW are the ones I've made. And if you keep going, you'll find some Adobe default ones in there. But ignore those because they're rubbish. Mine are better. So the 4K ones start with JW4K and the 1080p ones start with JWHD, just so you can simply see which ones are which. Now I've started a new sequence, and for the purposes of this video, let's just do it in 1080p. I've made it 24 frames a second. These will run at 24 frames a second because that is the frame rate that film normally takes. So to make these look the most filmic, that's the frame rate you should be using. So in my search bar up here, I'm going to type JWHD. And that's going to just isolate all the ones that are the HD ones, the 1080p ones. So these are all your templates here. So I'm just going to drag in a bit of stock footage of a man driving a car, and it looks very clean and contemporary. So let's add the LUT to make it look a bit old. So I'm going to go to my Lumetri color tab. I'm going to go to creative and I'm going to load up the LUT. And it's this one here, retrofilm.cube. And when we load it up, you can see the colors change there. And it looks quite different. If I turn that off and on, you can see the difference there. So now I'm gonna whack up the contrast a bit and maybe take down the saturation. Obviously you can tweak it however you like to get the look just right. No LUT is gonna be perfect for all footage, but this is kind of a base. So now we've got the LUT on the footage. I'm gonna grab one of these templates. I'm just gonna do this simple one here, and I'm gonna put this over the car footage here. So this is a simple fade in and fade out of text. So when we click it, what happens is rather than it now giving us an option to browse through all the various templates, we are taken to the edit where you can change it. So you can change the text, turn that bit off and on. You can change the font. You can change the size of the font. I'm going to add in my own text. I'm going to put starring and I'm going to put Jamie Windsor. There we go. So it stars me. So I'm going to make that a little bit bigger and I'm just going to move that down slightly. We can change the font here if we want, but we don't need to. now we've got that on top, what happens here is it kind of fades in and you've got the text over there. We've also just got a dust filter that I'd like to just add on top. And when we click the dust filter, we can change the amount of dust. We can put a lot of white and black dust like that, or we can turn it down a bit. We can turn the scratches. I'm going to turn the flicker up, scratches down a bit, about this much, a bit more white dust than black dust. What I'm also going to do is I'm going to put one of my transitions in. So I'm going to put this vignette in, and that basically just opens up a kind of vignette. And I'm also going to put in, what should I put in? Let's drop in a cigarette burn at the end. Now, a cigarette burn is what they call that little circle that used to appear in the top corner of a film frame to signal to the projectionist that it was time to change the reels over. So it's lots of little bits like that that just kind of make it seem a bit more authentic. So let's have a look at this. Okay, so I quite like that. Looks pretty good. I'm just going to put a little flare at the end. Now that was a fairly simple example, but they all work in much the same way. And you've got a load of different templates, all based on different kind of looks of 16mm film and old film titles and a bit of old screen text and some from specific films. Some very grindhouse and grungy, some a bit more VHS based. And they all have these editable elements, so you can change colours, you can change the depth of shadows, all with very simple sliders. For example, if I pick this sort of comic book looking one here, I can write what I want in there, change the font, let's change it to Cooper Black, change the background color to a reddy gray. If I didn't want a background at all, I can simply turn the background off and have the text overlaid onto a bit of footage. So I'm just going to move that up a little bit there and see how that looks. There we go, really simple, don't need any motion graphics knowledge, and you've got this retro looking footage now. So some of these will take a little bit longer to render, some of the more complex ones, some of them will be a bit simpler, a bit quicker, but they all should work as long as you've got the latest version of Premiere Pro. So when you download and unzip these, you should have this folder here, JW Retro Assets. In there are three other folders, the fonts, LUTs, and a MoGart folder, and that's your motion graphics templates. Now you want to install the fonts first, so if you go into here, you should have five fonts. JW VHS Mono, which is a VHS old typeface based on that, and it has play symbols and stuff in that as well. JW Godard, which is based on the typography of Jean-Luc Godard films. JW Nostromo, which is based on the Mother 6000 computer from Alien, which I've done a kind of version of in the templates. JW Pixel, which is used for some of the pixelated screen fonts. And lastly, we have JW Retro Wide. This isn't actually the default font in any of the motion graphics templates, but I thought I'd include it because it's got quite a retro look to it, and it works well on a lot of the old templates, especially the old grindhouse ones. We've got the LUTs folder, and that's just got the one LUT in there, retrofilm.cube. Then we've got the MoGarts folder, which has a 4K and a 1080p folder. So you can install whichever one of these you want to use, or both of them if you want. Each one should have 39 different templates in there. Now in Premiere Pro, you can just navigate to your Essential Graphics tab, press this little plus symbol here to install, and select the one you want and install it. But the problem with that is you can only do these one at a time, and there's 78 of them. So I'll show you a quicker way to do it. So what you need to do is locate your motion graphics template folder on your hard drive, and then you need to drag whichever folder, or both of them if you want, of the MoGarts into that folder, and then when you open Premiere, they'll be there. So I'm going to put the paths up on the screen that you have to follow to get to those folders. And let me show you how to do it on a Mac, because it's a little bit complicated. So you need to go to your hard drive, users, your username, and then you need to go to library. But you'll notice library isn't here, and that's because it's hidden. So rather than going through the path like that, simply open Finder, go to your Go menu up here, and then hold Option, and you'll notice this library option appears. Click library, and that's just a hidden folder, and there's your hidden library. Then you need to go to Application Support, Adobe, Common, that's your folder there, Motion Graphics Templates, and you simply drag these into there. Now, I don't have a Windows machine, but I also understand that that folder is hidden too. So what you need to do, apparently, is hit the Windows and R key to get the Run dialog box, then type this in, and that should open the folder, and then you just drag them into there. And as soon as you open Premiere, here they all are. So let's jump into After Effects now, and I'll show you some of the fundamentals for how to build your own looks that have a kind of old 16mm retro aesthetic to them. I appreciate everyone's at a different level in After Effects, so I'll try and explain everything I'm doing. So to start, I'm going to make a new composition. I'm going to hit Control or Command N for a new composition. 24 frames a second is good. I'm going to make it 10 seconds long and just HD, just for the purposes of this demonstration. So now I'm going to hit Control or Command Y to get a new solid, and I'm going to make this just a sort of neutral color, just so we can see what we're doing. I'll eventually delete that. So I'm going to make a new solid again, and I'm going to call this White Dust. And this is where we're going to create some dust. It doesn't matter what color the solid is. So with the layer selected, I want to go over to Effects and find Fractal Noise. So I'm going to start typing Fractal Noise. There we go. I'm going to double click that. So here we've got this kind of cloudy effect. I'll need to make the contrast a lot higher. So I'm going to go to the contrast over here and type 490 as the value. And then I'm going to go to the brightness and type negative 260. So what will happen now is, as the evolution of this goes on, we'll get these little specks of white dust kind of appearing. But what we want to do is have that kind of randomly jumping around by quite a lot. So I'm going to select the dust layer and then press E to show me my effects. And as Fractal Noise is the only effect, that's what is showing up there. I'm going to drop this down. I'm going to find Evolution, which is under Subsettings, and I'm going to Alt or Option click this stopwatch. And this will allow me to write an expression in here. The expression I'm going to write is Wiggle, W-I-G-G-L-E, open bracket. Now, the first value here is how many times a second it is. I'm going to type 24 because I want it to be different on every single frame, and it's 24 frames a second. Then I'm going to type a comma, and the next one is the parameters of how much the value will jump around. So I'm going to type 300,000. So what that should do now is create a jump around of all these little dots, and it looks quite dust-like. Now, if I want to make more dust, I can put the brightness up a little bit and we get a bit more, but I quite like it subtle, so I'm going to go minus 260. Now, I want to make the mode a screen layer, and if you can't see mode there, you need to right click and go to columns and make sure modes is selected. Now I'm going to make some black dust to go on top, and this is very simple. I just Command or Control D to duplicate. I'm going to call this Black Dust. Always a good idea to name your layers. I'm going to change this to a multiply layer. If I type UU, that's going to show me all the values I've changed. And where the brightness is, I'm just going to take away the negative, so it's 260 rather than minus 260. So now we've got flecks of black and white dust. And again, if we pull the brightness down a bit, we can get some more heavy black dust, but 260 is good for me at the moment. So now we don't need that solid at the bottom anymore, so I'm just going to select it and delete it. Next up, we're going to put some text in. And what you want to do when you're finding a good font is to look at maybe old film posters, maybe the title sequences for old films, old VHS idents, things like that. See what the fonts look like and maybe try and find out what they are. Try and find ones that look similar. Now, there's a good Adobe one that I found called Pragmatica Extended. This looks quite retro to me, so I'm going to type in retro type. And maybe I'm going to make that all capitals. I'm just going to go to my align palette and just make sure it's centered there. And I want to pull this underneath the dust. So we've got our type with the dust over the top of it. Now I want to add some effects to this. The first thing I'm going to add is a blur. I'm going to find a Gaussian blur. And Gaussian's how you pronounce that, by the way. So now we've got the Gaussian blur on it. I'm going to pull it up to see, just do this visually really. I think somewhere around there is good. And next I want to put a glow on it. Now we've got stylized glow, that's the one we want. I'm going to make the radius a lot bigger, really quite large. And the intensity I'm just going to take down to maybe 0.3. Maybe I'm going to make that a bit higher, 0.4. So now I'm going to want to make the text fade up and fade down. And with older footage, what seemed to happen is it would tint to a colour, maybe a red or a blue. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a fill layer on this. And I'm going to change that to maybe a kind of a deep red like that. I can press E to drop down my effects. And I'm going to put a keyframe for the colour. Here, I'm going to go to about another second, but another keyframe. And this one, I want to make just an off-white, just a kind of slightly yellowy grey colour. So what's going to happen is that's going to fade to that colour. I'm going to copy these keyframes, paste them, right-click them, go keyframe assistant, time reverse keyframes, and move them to about there. So what we've got now is it going from red to this white, and then back to red again. So what I'm going to do now is, having gone to my keyframe, I'm going to press T to get my opacity. I'm going to put a point there. Then I'm going to press U to open the keyframes. And I'm going to go back to the original keyframe here, put another opacity keyframe. I'm going to add in two more keyframes here. Now I'm going to make the end ones 0% opacity, so that it fades in and fades out. And what I'm going to do is make that fade a bit longer. So it fades in like that, and it kind of fades out with a red kind of glow. A lot of this you'll just need to do visually. There's no kind of ultimate way to do everything. Just kind of look and play around and see what feels right to you. So now we've got this fading in and fading out. Now, one important thing with text in old film is it would do two things. It would jitter and it would also drift. Two different kinds of movement. Now, the jitter is kind of every single frame, it just moves very, very slightly. And the drift is it would kind of move kind of slowly around to a certain degree. Now, I'm assuming this is to do with the way they scanned the film, or the way the film kind of moved as it was being shot, or telecined, or however it was being done. So the way we're going to do this in here is I'm going to add two null objects. So I want to go Shift Command Option Y or Shift Control Alt Y to get a new null. I'm going to do another one again there. I'm just going to name these. I'm going to call this one Jitter. I'm going to call this one Drift. Now I'm going to take this pick whip here on the retro type layer, and I'm going to parent that to the jitter layer. Then I'm going to go to the jitter layer's pick whip and parent that to the drift layer. And then we're going to do two wiggle expressions again. We are using a lot of wiggle expressions here. Now with these null objects selected, we want to press the P key to get the position control. And I'm going to alt click the stopwatch, and I'm going to type wiggle again. Then 24, then 0.5. So 24 comma 0.5 close brackets. And that will make the type just jitter around very slightly. So it's just kind of wobbling around. And 0.5 means how many pixels it's going to move by. And 24 is how many times a second it's going to do it. Now with the drift layer, we alt click the position again. Type wiggle again, open brackets. Then we're going to type 0.5 for the amount of time per second. So that's going to be once every 2 seconds, comma, I'm going to say 5 pixels. So the jitter is going to make it move by half a pixel 24 times every second, so once every frame. And the drift is going to make it move once every 2 seconds by a value of 5 pixels. So if we watch that now, we'll see that kind of drifts around and jitters. Now, if you want to make a more degraded look, a more kind of grindhousey look, increase the values in the wiggle, make it shake around a bit more, increase the dust, increase the blur, just increase everything, and it will start to look more and more degraded. So now maybe let's look at how we might animate this text. Now we've got this retro look to it. So if we jump back into After Effects here, I've taken off the fade in and fade out, and I've moved the effects, the glow and the blur, onto an adjustment layer so that they will affect everything below it. And if I scale up the type, the effects won't scale with it. So first off, I'm going to press Y to get my anchor point tool, and I'm just going to move it maybe into the middle of this O here. And while I'm on this layer, I'm going to press S to get my scale tool, and I'm also going to press R to get my rotation. Now I'm going to press U, which will open up everything with a keyframe on it, which will be the scale and rotation. So I'm going to move back a little bit, and I'm going to add more keyframes here. So here I'm going to scale up the text, maybe go right through the middle of the O there, and I'm going to rotate that by, say, 180 degrees. So what's happening here now is this is spinning into shot. Now, I think that comes in a little fast, so I'm just going to select this scale keyframe. I'm going to press Shift and F9 to make it an easy ease keyframe. So what we can do now is go to the fill up here, and I'm going to change this to maybe an orange like that. And I've set the mode as screen. Now I'm going to Command or Control D to duplicate that layer. And then I'm going to change the color of this maybe to a kind of a reddy purple like this. Duplicate it again. I'm going to change this to maybe a green. You never want these colors to be too bright or too saturated. And maybe this one's going to be a blue. So if I select these four type layers and I drag the playhead back so it's only a few frames in, then I press Option or Alt and the right square bracket, that will trim the layers down to only a few frames long each. Then I go to Animation, Keyframe Assistant and Sequence Layers, and that will then stagger the layers. And I'm going to make them their full length again by grabbing the ends and just dragging them back out. Then what we have is a staggered keyframe look. And because they're all screen layers, when they hit each other, they add to the brightness. So it ends up being kind of a white. Now I might need to move those up a little bit more just to give it a little bit more space. So there we go. We've got a nice kind of muddy rainbow coloured retro animation there. It looks quite retro with the dust on top of it and the way the colours come in. There's a load of ideas you can get if you look on places like YouTube for old things like VHS idents from the 80s and schools programs from the 70s. There's so much out there to find. Really get your head into it and try and see the type of animation that was going on. Look at the type of colors, look at old film posters, look at the kind of typefaces that were used, because all these things are an important part of creating this look. So I hope that helped. So hopefully all the people who were asking for me to make that video have found that helpful. I put a link below the video so you can go and get the motion graphics templates if you want to do it that way. I'm sorry I haven't been around much lately. I've been homeschooling my kids in lockdown. My wife's job is, she's an assistant head teacher, and she deals a lot with sort of students' welfare and looks after a lot of vulnerable children and stuff, so her job is much more important than mine. So I've kind of been looking after my kids while she's been going out to work. My kids are now back in school, but then they're going to be off for the summer holidays. I've been writing a lot. I haven't been able to film very much, basically, so that's why I've been kind of silent for a while. Anyway, there's loads of videos coming up, so you know, watch this space. And thank you to everyone who buys my Lightroom presets, because that helps fund my channel. And thank you for people who've been buying them while I've not been making videos. And thank you for the people who are still my patrons, even though I haven't uploaded anything for a month and a half. I really appreciate you guys, because it means I can keep doing what I'm doing, and I hope to resume normal service. In fact, it possibly might be a bit quicker, because I've got a load of ideas, a load of, half scripts written for a potential lot of videos, but the current situation at the moment is all a bit up in the air, so do what I can when I can. So anyway, I hope you guys are all doing okay, and remember to prioritise your mental health, because it's very important. Anyway, I will see you hopefully again soon. So, bye-bye.